Good morning and welcome to St Andrew's Roundhay. Whether you're watching live online or you're here in church, it's great to be with you. It's, I think, starting to feel a little bit more like normal, apart from masks, of course. And the last time I led worship, it was just to a camera. The theme of our service is keep on praying. And just because I like to be a little different, I've not gone with the set lectionary today. With all that's been going on in the world, not just COVID, but disasters and extremes of weather, I thought I'd look at how prayer plays an important part in how we deal with not just those things I've mentioned, but really just about anything in life. With the recent events in Afghanistan and Plymouth, prayers are needed to help and support the families affected. We'll light a candle. Loving God, we come together in worship, longing for tenderness, because this world can be hard. We come longing for light, because our lives are crowded with shadows. We come desperately needing direction. Fill us this morning with your peace. Your Spirit is our peace and our path. Amen. And our opening prayers. Let us pray. Jesus, you open us to new life, new hope, new possibilities. You conquer the way we close up, close down, and close in. Jesus, lover of us all, open our hearts to feel your compassion for people we would rather have walked past. Open our ears to hear the cries of the suffering deep inside, where we cannot fail to be moved. Open our understanding to new ways of living that do not diminish anyone. Open our eyes to see a vision of this world as you would have it. We seek you, God, in the spaces of our lives, the spaces between what we've done and what we've left undone, the spaces between our convictions and our actions, the spaces between all that we hoped to do and what we've actually done. We come with humility, knowing that we can't always see the way we've disappointed you, nor can we always see the long-term effects of the good we've done. This is a prayer for the road ahead, which is an empty space stretching before us. Fill us with a burning compassion for our brothers and sisters, a love that will not let us go. Give us courage to give boldly, love simply, hope deeply, risk greatly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And we join in with the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our opening hymn is from Mission Praise. All three this morning are from Mission Praise. It's number 128, and it's Father God, I Wonder. We'll sing it through twice. Please do sing through your masks, and if you're willing and able, please stand to sing. Thank you. Birthday time. We just have one birthday this morning, which is Woody, who's 8 years old, and it's actually his birthday today. I would sing, but I'm not going to. But happy birthday to Woody, and hopefully we'll be able to get his books to him in due course. We've not had anything for our family time, but please, if you're going on holiday, you're doing anything exciting over the coming weeks, take some pictures, some videos, whatever it is, and send it in to us so that hopefully we'll be able to put it up on the screen in the next few weeks. Usual email address, media@standrews.cc. So how many of you like to talk? I don't need a show of hands. I suspect most of us, and maybe some more than others. Now, is that mainly face-to-face, now that we can, or on the phone? I mean, if you use a mobile phone, you can text or use WhatsApp or FaceTime. Do any of you talk on the computer through emails or Skype, Zoom or Teams? That's what most of us seem to have been doing during COVID. Who do you like to talk to and what about? It's not rhetorical, so I don't want an answer. But talking with people is important to us, isn't it? We make sure that we can call others whenever we want. We also make sure people can reach us wherever we are. Maybe not always a good thing. It's great to talk to your friends at school or at home, and to your work colleagues and to your families. So if talking to people is easy, and we do it all the time, why is it so hard to spend time talking with God? How many of you pray? How many of you pray regularly? If I'm honest, I try to pray every day. I rarely sit down or kneel in a quiet spot to pray. It just happens at various times. If I hear a bit of sad news about, well, whatever, then that thought is in my mind and it becomes a prayer. Sometimes just driving around and something will make me think about saying a prayer, which I do in my mind. I try not to blurt it out while I'm driving. It's not always the best thing. God hears me. God hears us. However, whenever and wherever we pray. In its simplest definition, prayer is a conversation between the one who is praying and the one to whom those prayers are directed. Why is it important to talk to God? Well, God wants us to know him, and God really does answer prayer. God loves us through prayer. And we love God through prayer. Prayer can take many forms. It can be a cry for help or a cry of joy. It can be a single word or an essay. Pope John Paul II is quoted as follows on the difficulty of praying. How to pray? This is a simple matter. I would say, pray any way you like, so long as you do pray. And of course, prayers can be individual or corporate, liturgical or extemporary. They can be short or long, simple or complex in language. In fact, words are not always necessary. For we have the promise that when words fail us, the Spirit will intercede for us with the most intimate prayers of our heart. To the Celtic Church, their God was a personal and loving God, totally involved in the whole of the created world, which he had breathed into existence. The Celts knew that their God was involved totally in all of creation. They held firm to a belief in the incarnation and the knowledge that Jesus Christ lived, died, and rose again from death to show the great love of God for creation, and indeed for all of us. But the strength of the church is surely in a weaving together of all the strands of our Christian faith. One church, one faith, one Lord. I started this introduction by stating that at its simplest, prayer is a conversation. And conversations are rarely one-sided, apart from when you're talking to yourself. We all do that. Within our time of prayer, there needs to be the silence that enables God to contribute. And we'll explore that a bit further shortly. If I could ask one of the stewards to bring the collection plate forward, and we'll dedicate our offerings. Let us pray. Lord, we are thankful for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can always trust in you. You're an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you our gifts today. With them, we worship you and give our whole selves to you. Please now take it and use it for your kingdom and your glory. Extend and multiply its reach and influence. May it be a great blessing to many. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Before Margaret leads us in our readings, we'll sing our second hymn, which is Mission Praise 37, As the Deer Pants.
Our first reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 32, beginning at verse 22. Jacob wrestles at Peniel. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Second reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, beginning at verse 1, the parable of the widow and the judge. Then Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, "In a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor had respect for people. In that city there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, 'Grant me justice against my opponent.' For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, 'Though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice so that she may not wear me out by continually coming.'" And the Lord said, "Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?" Amen.
Thank you, Margaret. There was a cartoon in a newspaper that has a little boy kneeling beside his bed for his bedtime prayer and saying with some measure of disgust, "Dear God, Uncle Jim still doesn't have a job. Sis still doesn't have a boyfriend. Grandma is still feeling sick, and I'm tired of praying for this family and not getting results." Praying was a problem for this little guy, and he isn't alone. Prayer is a problem for many people now. I'm sure lots of prayers have been said during the last 18 months, and in fact, I'm sure still are, even more so with what's happened in the last few days. If it wasn't a problem, then why are there so few people who take prayer seriously? If it isn't a problem, then why do we find it so hard to set time aside every day to spend with God in prayer? If we took prayer seriously, then we wouldn't hesitate to be persistent and consistent in the time we spend in conversation with God. And if we really believe that God is a God of love, forgiveness, compassion, and gentleness, that he can change us, heal broken lives, and restore severed relationships, then we would really be serious about praying to God. In fact, if we really believed this, then no one and nothing would be able to keep us from praying. But the problem is that too often our efforts and sincerity in prayer give way to discouragement. We simply give up. And if you think that this is a particularly modern problem, think again. It was also an issue back in Jesus' day. And so Jesus teaches his disciples about prayer through parables and words of encouragement. Earlier in Luke's gospel, one of the disciples asked Jesus, "Lord, teach us to pray." It's not that this disciple had never prayed before, but he had seen something different in the way Jesus prayed and wanted to learn more. And Jesus obliges and gives us what we now know as the Lord's Prayer, as a kind of model prayer. In Luke 18 that Margaret just read, we hear Jesus talking about prayer again. There is most likely something more to the background of this. Perhaps one of the disciples had become frustrated with praying because it seemed that God didn't hear or want to answer his prayers. So Jesus tells a parable about a truly disgusting judge. This judge had no respect for justice and no feeling for the suffering of others. In Jesus' day, there were those judges who were notorious for accepting bribes, for being corrupt and perverting the course of justice. We hear of a widow who has a case to bring to the judge, but since she is a widow, she has nothing to offer as a bribe. Neither does she have anyone to speak on her behalf. She has no standing in the society of the time. She is a picture of helplessness. But she does have one thing. She has the ability to pester the judge. And even though the judge wants nothing more to do with this woman, she doesn't give up. She leaves messages on his answering machine, constantly appears in his office, writes him letter after letter, sends texts, emails. She gives him no peace. She is persistent. She wanted justice, and she wanted it now. Finally, this judge says to himself, "Even though I don't care about God and I cannot stand this woman, I will give this woman what she wants just to get her out of my hair." There are two points that come out of this parable. Firstly, the widow was in a helpless situation. She could have easily lost heart and given up. As someone who was a nobody in her community, too poor to resort to bribery and lacking in influential friends, the chance of her having any success was nil. And what is more, she couldn't count on the religious principles of the judge because he had none. She is a picture of helplessness, and if she lost heart, who would blame her? And this is the case with much of our praying. I believe one of the big issues that we face in our praying is that we don't come to God in helplessness and with an earnestness like the widow. We are often far too half-hearted about what we are praying and don't really believe that God will give us what we want. If we really believed that God hears and answers our prayers, if we were convinced that prayer changes things, heals broken lives and restores severed relationships, then we, like the woman, would be hammering on God's door constantly, asking, sometimes growing angry. In the face of every difficulty, we would not lose heart, but consistently and persistently keep on going to God, even though we have become discouraged. Our accompanying passage from Genesis describes Jacob looking after a large camp of people. He also had his wives and 11 children with him. It's quite a complex reading, but my take from it very briefly is that there was always plenty of work, plans, and decisions to be made by Jacob, which was good. But he was ridiculously busy with everything other than spending time with God. And he was also preparing for a huge tussle with his brother Esau. So with everything going on, it probably had a tendency to crowd out God and prayer. So God appears to Jacob as an unknown person and grapples with him throughout the night. And eventually, Jacob has his hip literally put out of joint. And it is at this point that he realizes that the man he is fighting is divine. And he realizes that all this time, his attention has been away from God. And it was then when Jacob was intentionally alone that he could really focus back on God. This is also true with us. Busyness and life circumstances tend to hinder our time with God. The Bible records some of the prayers of people who have gone to God with their seemingly hopeless situations. Some of the bitterest complaints about God and his ways are to be found in the Bible. In the Psalms and the book of Job, the cries of bitter and angry people are there for us today. Rather than lose heart and give up on God, they persistently called out to him, "How long, O God? My God, why? Though I cry out day and night, you don't answer me. In times of trouble, I pray to the Lord. All night long, I lift my hands in prayer, but I cannot find comfort. I feel discouraged." We hear of Jesus praying on the night of his arrest. Luke's gospel says, in great anguish, he prayed even more fervently. His sweat is like drops of blood falling to the ground. But even though Jesus was in a hopeless situation, he did not lose heart. He prayed even more fervently. It would have been easy for that widow to give up, because the odds were against her of ever moving the corrupt judge to do anything in her favour. In spite of how things might look to you, and how overpowering chaos and trouble are in your life, and even though the situation appears hopeless, Jesus urges us not to lose faith, but to keep on praying. I said there are two points that I'd like to make. The first one, if we believe that prayer is important, then nothing should keep us from praying. And the second point is what this parable says about the character of God. If that sleazy and corrupt judge, who had no real interest in the widow at his door, will open his hand and answer the requests of the widow, then how much more will God? It is God who has a deep and intimate concern with everything that happens in our lives and has promised to answer our prayers and petitions. This parable is about the trustworthiness and generosity of God. If a crooked judge can give what he's asked for, how much more will God, who is gracious and kind, give us what we ask for in prayer? Jesus said something similar to this after the parable about the man who persistently knocked on his neighbor's door at midnight. He said, "Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will God give good gifts to those who ask him?" You see, if sinful parents give good things to their children because they love them, then it follows that God, who promised to love us as his own at our baptism and to walk with us throughout life's journey, will never ignore our prayers and will always answer them in the most loving way. Our text today reassures us that God does hear our prayers, just as the judge heard the widow and her pleadings. We can take comfort in the knowledge that God is far more gracious than the dishonest judges. He answers out of his goodness and kindness and grace. If his answers depended on us, on how well we pray, on how well we have lived as God's people, then we could never expect to have our prayers answered. I'm sure all of us this morning admit that prayer doesn't have the place in our lives that it should. Even as we confess our slackness when it comes to praying, he answers that prayer out of love and reminds us that we belong to him. His answers are always good. His answers are never vengeful or vindictive. As God's child, you can count on that. This parable of Jesus about the widow and dishonest judge is a story about encouragement. Jesus is saying, take heart. Don't give up praying just because times are hard. Keep on praying. Why? Because of the relationship that we have with our God. Keep on praying because he is gracious and kind. Keep on praying even if the whole situation looks hopeless in our eyes. Keep on praying because he loves us and is waiting to answer our prayers in a way that will be for our benefit. Keep on praying because we have a God who is willing and waiting to hear from us and who wants to apply his loving answer to every request that we bring to him. Yes, sometimes we may doubt. We may be angry. We may be upset. We may question why. But he is always there to listen. Remember, prayers are rarely answered immediately or in the way you may expect. We've been praying for an end to this pandemic for ages now, yet we're still in it. And some countries way more than us. Tomorrow marks another shift in that if you're double vaccinated, you don't need to isolate if you've been in close contact with a positive test. Good news? Or just a way to get society back? Prayers, I believe, are answered. But we are very blinkered. We only see what's in front of us, not what's to the sides. And that can be where the answers to our prayers are. So what I'm saying is don't look for a direct answer. It's likely that the answer that you want is hidden to one side or the other. You just have to find it. The theology of prayer is this. It is a thing that invites God into the day-to-day affairs of mankind. The thing that invites God into the day-to-day affairs of mankind. Amen. Before our intercessions, we'll have our last song. Now, this is one of my favourites. The lyrics read very much like a prayer. So you could say a kind of sung prayer. Mission prays again, longing for light.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Think of an area of your life that is causing you some concern, and ask God to give you wisdom. The Lord hears our prayer. Think about a relationship that is causing you hurt or concern, and ask God to give you understanding. The Lord hears our prayer. Think about a part of your life that is a cause of great joy and celebration, and ask God to share in it with you. The Lord hears our prayer. Think of some challenge you are facing, a time of uncertainty, and ask God to grant you peace and strength. The Lord hears our prayer. Think of the times when maybe you should have been a different person and acted in a better way towards others, and ask God to help you become that individual. The Lord hears our prayer. Think of the times when you couldn't be bothered or something was beneath you, and ask God to give you energy and enthusiasm. The Lord hears our prayer. Think of an area of the church's life that frustrates or disappoints you, and ask God to give you peace and hope. The Lord hears our prayer. Think of this church and its congregation, its worship, its witness, its service in the community, and through prayer, let us be open to seeking God's will. The Lord hears our prayer. Think of our nation, especially events in Plymouth. Our leaders, other countries, particularly Afghanistan, people in poverty, those struggling through the pandemic, those we know personally, those who have lost so much through natural disasters. Remember the people of Haiti after the earthquake last night. And those driven away by wildfires. And we think of those through no fault of their own who have lost so much. And we ask God to heal and bless everyone. The Lord hears our prayer. Think about yourself. Perhaps you are becoming more aware of God's presence in your life and more open to His purposes for you. Ask Him to fill you with His love and his power. The Lord hears our prayer. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you to John for playing the piano, for Margaret the readings, and to our AV team. I hope you have a great week ahead. Look after yourselves and remember to say your prayers. And we close with a blessing. Loving God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, feeding us with your word, and encouraging us in our worship together. Take us and use us to love and serve you and all people in the power of your Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.